Welcome! In this video, we're diving into why every single person who does an Enneagram test for the first time mistypes. Hello and welcome back to the channel. My name is Gabby.
I'm Isabel.
Here at Making Mindfulness Fun, we are here to help you live your purpose and be the hero of your story so that you can have your dream relationships, vibrant health, and the career that you love. Okay, so Enneagram is a huge cornerstone of living your amazing life where you have that dream relationship, career, and life. But the problem is, we've noticed, working with people for years around the Enneagram and personality archetypes, everyone tests their Enneagram wrong. And a lot of people know this. A lot of people are aware of the struggle of Enneagram mistypes. And Isabel has created a long series of content comparing your possible mistypes. Say, for example, an Enneagram 5 versus an Enneagram 9. How can you tell the difference? She has great content on that. But we wanted to dive into in this video why people mistype their Enneagram. And that way, if you are someone who's watching this, you can think about if these are some things you might notice in yourself. And remember, when you're testing for your Enneagram, we're trying to use the Enneagram not to box you in, but to understand your core struggles and your core gifts. When you know your core struggles and your core gifts, instead of trying to, it's like knowing the target that you're actually headed towards. This is actually my skill set that I can use as I head toward this target, and here are the hurdles that are going to come up along the way. If we think that we're the wrong Enneagram, we think these are the hurdles, but we're actually start running down the road and we all of a sudden run into a wall because we weren't aware that those were our obstacles.
Right. And so a big part of why everyone mistypes their Enneagram, including me, when I first did the Enneagram test, I thought I was certain that I was an Enneagram 5 wing 4. And I thought that was so me. Yeah, I'm intelligent and logical and reserved and introverted. And then I went to go tell Gabby and my mom about it, and they're like, that's not you at all. And that, me as an Enneagram 9 was like, oh, well, okay. It sounded right, but we can try again. So eventually I discovered that I was actually an Enneagram 9. And here's how you can actually know when you've tested your Enneagram correctly, is that instead of going, oh my god, that's so me, you kind of go, ouch, that's me.
Yeah.
So part of why finding your Enneagram and mistyping is so common is because we don't want to see that part of ourselves. Why does it hurt when we find out our Enneagram? Because Enneagram is based around our childhood wound, also known as your programming, which we talk about a lot here at Making Mindfulness Fun. So there are 9 key programmings that people grow up with, and that is determines your Enneagram. You'll have one of those programmings. So the Enneagram 9s is, for example, they fear rocking the boat because they believe that they cannot have conflict or they will be abandoned. And so discovering that can feel very like a touchy subject for us. And to see that can feel hurtful because then we realize all the things that we have quote unquote done wrong in our past when really we're all beings with programming who are all going to act from that place, mm-hmm. and we're all going to struggle with our programming.
Yeah, and so similar to Isabel, when I tested for the first time, now granted, I'm trying to remember if it was actually via a test, it might have just been through infographics, but it doesn't matter. When I first discovered the Enneagram, I thought I was an Enneagram 4. And the reason that I thought I was an Enneagram 4, now note that I'm an Enneagram 3. I'm pretty much an Enneagram 3 to a T. Isabel would tell you that. I totally did not think I was a 3. I've literally been in competitive sports my whole life and have constantly been striving to get the next achievement my whole life. And yet, in that moment, I thought, oh, I'm a 4. And here's why. I thought I was a 4 because I thought by identifying that I'm a 4, then it would tell the people in my life that, hey, I'm a 4. By telling them I'm a 4, it would tell them, like, you don't understand how much I feel like I'm a nobody. We latch on to certain Enneagrams because what that Enneagram supposedly wants is also what we want. And that's the thing about being human. Everyone wants all of these things. I'm not an Enneagram 9, of course I want peace. Like, I'm not an Enneagram 5 and I want to be capable. I'm not an Enneagram 4 and sometimes I want to feel special. But I am an Enneagram 3 because when I started going into it, I was like, I'm a 4. Suddenly I discovered, I ended up on an information track where I was researching and then I was reading about the Enneagram 3 and the core wound of an Enneagram 3, and they were talking about how the Enneagram Enneagram 3 strives for achievement because at the core of it, they feel like they have to prove that they're good in some way, because at the root, they feel as though they are not good enough. And that was the moment I was like, okay, I'm a 3. And so everyone, this is what I talk about in other videos, everyone battles not enoughness in some way or another, but there's certain beliefs about what you think you have to do to prove your enoughness. So like a 5 proves their enoughness through information. A 3 does that through achievement. A 9 does that through peacemaking. These different ways, but in one great book that Isabel can remind me the name of, what's the book that talks about the core wounds?
The Enneagram Guide to Waking Up.
The Enneagram Guide to Waking Up. That one's amazing because, like Isabel just said, you're going to read them and it's suddenly going to feel like vulnerability. The difference between the one you identify with and the one that you actually are, one will say, oh, that's me. And the other one will say,
ouch. And that's another thing to add on with. Another reason people mistype is not only because they don't want to see, we're all afraid of seeing that weak part of ourselves, that little vulnerable wound, but also because we truly do have the desires within each of us of each Enneagram. Now, I talk about this a lot in my Enneagram Growth Hacker still, that you, based on your Enneagram, you're still going to want your core desire more than all the other desires. The other Enneagrams show you how you attain that core desire. So an example of the 9, the core thing I want is peace. But with a wing 8, I need to have some challenge. And with a wing 1, I need to have some organization in order to maintain that sense of peace. And then there's also the tri-types, which we will not dive into in this video because they are complicated in themselves. But you have parts of every Enneagram basically within you, and that adds to how you fulfill your core desire. And sure, you can go through life not knowing your Enneagram. You can say that, you know what, I'm certain that I want to be an 8. And sure, go for it. But what's going to end up happening is that you cannot become a creator of your life if you don't identify your true programming, because your programming is going to drive everything you do. Even I notice now how my programming as a 9 is keeping me from reaching the deepest level of peace and fulfillment that I could possibly have.
Yeah, this is so, really at the root of it, knowing what your Enneagram is helps, or is so easy when you know what your story is. What your story is as a child, how you arrived here. And that's a masterclass that I'm going to be hosting this week in Be The Hero Academy. Be The Hero Academy is our live group coaching membership platform where you log in, you get access to this amazing network of live group coaching and workshops that we do, and also daily motivation and inspiration. And if you're watching this video right now, at the end of November, then you can still sign up and join my live group workshop. But I'm gonna be talking about how to identify your story, how to know your story. That way you can truly figure out who you are, how you arrived here, and what your Enneagram is became in the process.
Right. So if you're not watching it before that date though, you should still join Be The Hero, because we are always providing information on how to be the creator of your reality. And we help you do this through understanding your programming, breaking free of it, understanding your personality. We send you daily texts for astrology. We cover everything, and it's super simple to follow. It's never a bad time to join Be The Hero. So hit the link below to join Be The Hero.
Yeah, and the other thing, so here's the second reason why people Enneagram mistype. And I think this one's really important too, because this one's not your fault to some degree. Like, none of it, our programming is not our fault. Our programming comes from people outside of us. And on top of it, what we think we're supposed to be also comes from outside of us. So your programming is all these belief systems, right? Stacking, stacking, stacking. Money is scarce. You know, relationships are hard. All of these things that we hear as a child that creates, oh, or like, I'm not capable, I'm not enough, all these things. Well, also in that belief system, we also tell me, like, it's better to be fun, or it's better to be the best. It's right. Better to be a capable person. It's better. You are better if you are certain characteristics. And so I think one of the examples I want to use is that I see often, you know, 4s identify as 7s, and 7s often identify as 3s. This is an interesting mistype combination that we see often. And here's the reason for it. Let's use the example of the 7s who think that they're 3s. You can use the other, tell us about the other example. But the 7s who think that they're 3s is a very interesting one, because for most people, for most of the other Enneagrams, we look at 7s and we go, oh my gosh, everyone likes sevens, right? As sevens are the life of the party. They're the people that truly don't have any enemies because they just manage to keep the harmony, keep the peace, and, like, keep it fun.
Everyone, yeah, positive.
Keep it positive, even if they're not the loudest people. But the funny thing is, type seven's strength is that they can always find the fun. They always know that they can always make things fun, but their weakness is that they don't allow themselves to feel. They don't allow themselves to feel negative emotions, and so they can't actually step into their deepest joy because they've blocked off a lot of emotion. The irony is, sevens, who everyone wants to be and to some degree, sevens think that they're threes often. And the reason for that is because sevens who have a little bit of this ego battle of, I gotta be seen and I gotta make sure everyone likes me, and they kind of want to have this level of reputation to some degree, they want to be threes. Because somewhere along the way, as sevens, they who didn't want to receive negative, in the process of them not wanting to have negative emotions, they may have also in the process tried to be fairly good achievers. When I say fairly good achievers, I mean that they probably didn't, they might have done well in school, they might have done well in sports, they might have done well in these things that would make them appear as achievers in their own mind's eye. I always worked so hard to do well, but they did that from a space of they didn't want to feel the negative emotions of parents or teachers criticizing them.
Right. So that's like the 4 or 7 to 3 mistype, but then there's an even common one too that is the 4 thinking that they're the 7. And these two are very similar. You meet a lot of 7s, and in some ways they seem to be like, oh, I'm quirky, I'm unique, but they don't do it for the sake of being unique. The 4's core desire is to be important to the world. And so there's a lot of different ways 4s do that. Some do it by being more quiet or focusing on their art or like going their own route, but it's very common that they think to themselves growing up, how do I become important? And then they see the 7 being fun. They see the 7 being the life of the party. They see them getting all the attention and everyone saying that they like the 7 because they're so fun. And so the 4 tries to be the 7 and be the life of the party. And this is where you can see the difference between the 4 and the 7, is that the 7 eventually learns that they can't always be the life of the party, but they can rally the party. Whereas the 4 will go from trying to be important to being the life of the party and making themselves the center, not necessarily rallying the party, just seeing if they can get the eyes on them. And so the 4 goes about fulfilling their core desire in thinking that they are a 7 because they want to be the life of the party, but the root of it is that they want to be important. And the 7 may want to feel important, but they'd rather feel positive than be important.
Yeah, so those are 2 brief overviews. We actually went into them in pretty close detail. But if you guys want to hear us break down some common mistypes, let us know in the comments, and we'll try our best to make a series about that. Because and Isabel already has an amazing series on it on Instagram. Do you have a blog series on it?
I have a blog.
Yeah, we'll put the links to the blogs in the description down below. And so that kind of covers why people and your mistype. The general gist of what that second part was all about is that notice if there's a story you're telling yourself about what is better to be. I, as a 3, also might have identified as a 4 because I thought, well, creatives are better. People who, type 3 sounded like egotistical, selfish people in my head, maybe when I first read it. I think that is what I thought. Like, those people are like, they're rude. They're not kind to other people. Maybe I wanted to be a little bit more 2-ish than 4-ish, which would be my 2 wings. And so notice what story you're telling yourself about what's better to be. And then going back to our first point, try to think about what part of you, what is your true programming deep down afraid of? What is that core feeling when you're laying in bed at night and you're spiraling, like something negative happened, something triggered you, and you start thinking about all these things? What is that core feeling? What's that core fear down at the root? Is it I'm not enough? Is it I need to keep the peace? Is it that I'm not special? I'm a nobody. I'm not lovable. Whatever it is, try to be vulnerable with yourself. You don't have to share that with the world yet. At some point, you want to be vulnerable with people close in your life, but you got to start with being vulnerable with yourself first to become the creator of your reality.
Right. And so you should definitely check out the links in the description below to learn more about the mistypes, but you should also join Be the Hero, because as much information as you can take in, I know I'm the kind of person who wants to take in all the information, do it all on my own. I can find my own Enneagram. I know the best. And then once I know it, I know how to do everything. it can be so much faster to get on your path to growth and start being creator of your reality instead of being a subject to your programming by joining Be the Hero by hitting the link below, and we guide you through it every day. So link is below for that, and thank you for watching this video.
Namaste.